For those who don't know me, I'm Yeo Kang Shua, Associate Professor at the Architecture and Sustainable Design. This evening, we are very pleased to have Professor Katherine Ingraham with us. And let me quickly introduce you to Professor Katherine, for those of you who doesn't know her illustrious career. I was telling Katherine that as an undergraduate, I read the critical journal, Assemblage, as part of my undergraduate studies. And Katherine is one of the editors to this interesting architectural theory and history journals. And for those of you who are perhaps unfamiliar with this particular journal, you may want to search of it on the library database. So Katherine is a professor at the graduate program of the architecture at Pratt Institute of Pratt Institute in New York City. She received her doctoral training from the Johns Hopkins University as a visiting faculty member at the Graduate School of Design, Harvard University, as well as the Graduate School of Architecture, Planning and Preservation at the Columbia University. So apart from her role in editing various journals, as what I mentioned earlier, Assemblage, she has been publishing a number of very influential books, including The Architecture Theory, published by MIT Press in forthcoming in 2023, Architecture Animal Human by Rowlatch in 2006, as well as Architecture and the Burden of Linearity by Yale University in 1998. So with that, without further ado, let us put our hands together and welcome Professor Katherine Ingraham. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I know. Okay, so this works well, it seems like. And thank you very much for coming. It's really a pleasure to be in Singapore for the first time. It's actually the first time I've been even put my foot on an Asian country, and so I'm intrigued by what I've learned in the last week and a half, and continue to learn until the end of this week. And so we've been some of the students from Pratt Institute came over with David Erdman, who's the chair of the architecture program in New York, the graduate program at Pratt Institute in New York. And so this has been very interesting to have them coming and looking and doing a project around the Golden Mile complex and moving in and out of, super interesting architectural issues in the city, planning issues, developmental issues, and so forth. Tonight, it's going to be a little bit different probably approach to some of the questions that we've been asking about architecture during these past couple of weeks, but also what we do in architectural school. And it's different because in some way some of it is from earlier philosophical sort of relationships to architecture, that part of what the magazine Assemblage was about. It was about this transitional period where we were theorizing architecture in different ways, and that went on for perhaps a decade, and then it gave way to digital revolution in the late 90s, and then it began to come back in a different way in the early 2000s. And continues to reemerge in different forms, but also has its legacy. So part of that is what I'm bringing to you today. I can't cover the ground that the title promises of Architecture in the World, Ecosystems, enormous project, enormous span of everything that we, that we think about and that we are in the midst of, and so forth. It's a huge subject matter in itself, and so what I decided to do was break it down a little bit to three sort of aspects of how one would go about thinking about this question of architecture and ecosystems. One of them is what used to be called biomodernity, and I'll talk a little bit about that. The second, both the first and the second one are relatively short, and the third one is a little longer. But the second one is about technology, based on the question of technology that Heidegger famously wrote at a certain point. And the third one is a little bit of pulling those two together, the biomodernity and the question of technology, but also trying to figure out this incredible question about, like, what is nature? Because we think we know what it is, and we keep, you know, grasping for understanding of it, and we also try to use it in a, you know, in a responsible way, and yet it eludes us all the time. And so how that question can be posed and how we would deal with it in architecture is a huge issue. The we want to deal with it, and I can see that Singapore is opening certain kind of door to it, that, you know, with its greening of the city, the greenery, the different aspects of the greenery developments here. So, and I'm still trying to figure that out, too. I mean, I'm trying to figure out why the trees should be up on the 12th floor, you know, and it so happens that I was staying at the hotel that had those trees, and I sat down. It was very nice to have them there, I have to say, and the wind and sort of breezy sort of huge lounge area. So it clearly is delightful at some level, and yet I still at some other aspects of it that are that I've seen, I don't particularly understand what we're doing architecturally. But that said, I'm not going to talk specifically about Singapore because I know very little. You can't know very much in a couple of weeks. But it's on my mind while I was sort of developing this lecture. So the last section, the third section, is about that question, what is nature or where is nature? And it will include a few aspects of that problem and probably won't get into what we're going to end up getting into inevitably, you know, with having to really figure something out about it that will allow for us to change our relationship to it. So first I just wanted to tell people what they already know probably, which is about the definition of an ecosystem. And earlier today we were talking a little bit about this as well, that ecosystems are descriptions of how living systems are ordered in relation to environments. And so the living system is a biotic system, it's alive, and the environment is abiotic, it's not alive. And so it's the animate and the inanimate that must become related to each other in some way in order for the living system to survive. An ecosystem is unique for each organism, and it's based really on the cognitive capacity of the organism to gather information, nutrition, oxygen, whatever it needs from the environment in order to sustain itself. And I'm going to talk about that a little bit more in the third section of the talk. Architecture is also about ordering. It orders living systems through the production and design of environments, which a second order, means that it's something like a second order milieu. A milieu is that combination of the living system and the environment, that special thing that you form in order to keep your species alive. And I think that the second order milieu of architecture is suggesting that we build these relationships between environments and living people, like human beings particularly. And yet it's a smaller set of relationships. It's an internal kind of housing of life that you could say many organisms have similar forms of protective structures and design surroundings. So it's not quite as expansive on the internal level, but of course it's drawing from the environment of materials of every kind. It's searching for resources and using resources and inventing relationships to resources. So my question here is going to be in the direction of how do we attach architecture to the bio, to the ecosystems, through the usual techniques of representation, merger, blending, doing all sorts of things, appropriating through tech, engineering, and design. How do we make that attachment to the bio? How deeply do we go into that? We've heard about architecture using nature as spiritual, ornamental, artificial additions to the material world that is already in place, to precedents and so forth. We've heard about it as sources, the source of resources, material, buildings and utilities and water and so forth, and a recognition of life, labor, work, alliances with political systems, society, economies. And we also know of our relationship in architecture to nature through our desire for beauty and happiness, which is more psychological and not directly related to the character, let's say, but to a desire for an attribute or an aesthetic development. So how to approach this? The biopolitical part is, I'm going to start with an Italian philosopher who is doing a really interesting work on biomodernity. In the last part of the 20th century, I invited this professor, Giorgio Agamben, whom I do not know personally and did not know then, to a conference I had organized at Columbia University entitled Part Animal, Architecture and Life. Professor Agamben graciously responded with interest, but also the news that he was currently refusing to come to the United States as a matter of protest, because he did not want to hand over the biometric information now routinely demanded at border crossings. Such information seemed at first utterly banal, date, place of birth, gender, but it has now progressed to x-rays and physical searches of bodies. The now relentless collection of information of every kind about our personal lives, which Agamben had predicted, is a symptom, in his view, of how biological life has become what is at stake in the political meaning, government, society. It's become what's at stake. Professor Agamben hastened to add in his response to my invitation that he had turned down other offers for the same reason, and also that Europe was no better than the United States. Agamben's work was, and still is, concerned with reviving and developing some of Michel Foucault's thinking in the 1970s about biopolitics and its structural relevance to modernity, sovereignty, and institutions. Agamben's long-term project, which is super fascinating but doesn't really pertain to architecture, so I'm kind of leaving most of it out, but he's looking at the way in which economics developed out of religion, and he's been publishing this work quite over a number of years in very small, dense books that is concluded in a large book. But this was widely read in multiple disciplines and as well widely criticized for what it saw as a reduction of the concept of the biological to a single universal idea, which he called bare life. In other words, just the raw matter of bare life, of being biologically an animal, in so to speak, in spite of all the qualifications of that we think of when we think of human being human. The immediate relevance of Agamben's work to architecture's diverse relationships to nature, and I'm now going to make this awkward sort of thing, nature with a capital N, as organic, picturesque, landscaped, infrastructural, site-specific, property, sustainable, versus nature with a small n, which is unknown, has been the close attention he pays to the meaning of biological life now as a central concern of contemporary political and cultural systems. His fleshing out of the concept of biomodernity in a direction Foucault implied but did not follow. I forgot to tell you that the images are, oh, how do I do this? I guess I have to do this. Is this right? No, it doesn't work. Let me get the other way. Oh, I turned it off. That's good. Okay. There. The images are not directly related to any specific thing I'm saying, but they're related to the sections. In other words, biomodernity here in the term of the Pompidou Center, or the team's arrange light life to, refers to projects that seem to be producing a new order, or suggesting by moving things around, or rearranging things, suggesting this ordering that I've talked about, and working toward that or a relationship between ordering and environments. But they're very, it would require a whole different discussion to actually say how and why, and is it, you know, significant. But I wanted to just bring that to mind. That the back to Agamben, his work reflects in important ways architecture's formal aesthetic and functional attention toward the complex living systems integral to its realization. That the architectural program, with its tidy typologies of living, like, you know, bedroom, living room, kitchen, has kept life out of its thoughts, is due in part to the systemic character of spatial organization and its ability to be separated, to a certain degree, from the act of design. Design imagines possible dispositions of structures from which we try to bring something new to the ordering of life. The program, which is, we're still talking really about the modernist program, derived from design, and its typological proprieties make a strong, upfront, almost always commercial appearance in contemporary architectural work. The program fits in with its time and its place, but it is not flexible. It's usually serendipitously changed by some pushing against the fact that the living room now becomes the kitchen and the living room, and not just the kitchen and a separate thing in the living room. So it goes through these changes, but it's a slow and rather, you know, sort of almost accidental kind of change. It is easier to change the design of a building rather than the program because it's so heavily qualified by precedents, laws, organizational matters of space, according to prevailing typologies, historical patterns, and already in place arguments for why you need a living room. But I think the many attempts of architects, historians, theorists, not to mention the planners and the public, discover in the discipline and practice of architecture cultural and political relationships between architecture and life, lifestyles, primitive hut, theories of inhabitation, cultural techniques, environmental sustainability, and testify to the still uncertain, constantly shifting nature of these relationships. Biomodernity itself is qualified by the centuries-long evolution of modernity, which disputedly either starts in the Renaissance or the 18th century, depending on which historian you're talking to. I'll say a little bit more about that and sort of give it a little bit more flesh shortly. The evolution of modernity, which modernist architecture in the, you know, early part of the 20th century occupied really for slightly more than a century. Agamben argues that biomodernity has drastically disrupted our conception of modernity in political and aesthetic terms. Modernism's nature, capital N, the cartoon of nature that lies outside the autonomous architectural structure, sitting on its modernist plinth, for example, is recast by Agamben's inquiry to our biological nature, small n, that has come to be all that is at stake in modern human culture. We already know about this to some degree through, you know, technologies that are trying to get closer to us. And Agamben refers to the cell phone in particular, not in a negative way, but just to say we can't put it down. We're addicted to it. It now belongs to us. It's only a matter of time before it attaches itself, you know, permanently to us. This might mean, in modernist terms, that while modernist architects wish to establish ways of living that theoretically correspond with ideas of modernity expressed as minimalist aesthetic and spatial structures inspired by industrial technologies, the living of life itself had already been appropriated by the apparatuses of the state. But the state and the technology go together to a certain degree. It is, of course, useful for the state to run a health program that uses good technology of communication and so forth. So it's not, again, not negative or I'm not being cynical about this, or neither is Agamben. It's just that apparatuses of the state are necessary since the 18th century, at the very least, when we began to develop institutionalized sort of systems and later corporations and so forth. Technologies, which modernist architects privileged in architectural narratives, were very instrumental in this capture. But again, it was not surprising, nor is it bad per se. It's not a criticism. It's a kind of a note about who pushes this. Does technology push push for the apparatuses that then come around and control us as citizens and people who live, you know, in countries and states? Or does it work the other way around? Does the state sort of develop a technology in order to control people? Or is it not about control, but simply about supplementing our health care so that we stay healthy longer, and so on? So this is a very interesting set of relationships. Such a reversal is not a simple substitution of ecology or biology for formalism or culture, nor is it a sudden revelation about nature and natural systems or sustainability. Instead, it is a polemic, it's Agamben's polemic in effect, that studies this complex entwinement of natural life and political life in relation to apparatuses, and I mentioned the cell phone, but apparatuses in Agamben's list is everything that is institutional and not living. And it turns out that, of course, these institutions need living people to be run. And so the apparatus our relationship to the apparatus is fundamental. Erwin Schrödinger's observation, to put this in here now, without too much explanation, but it's really pretty crucial to how this develops. Observation that living systems extract order from their surroundings is a little bit closer to the mark here of what we're looking at in the apparatus and sort of living system relationship. That and Schrödinger does this, you know, has this amazing book called What is Life? And in that book, he argues that there's this huge dilemma, and the dilemma is that, you know, the environment is entropic. It's it's running out of steam. It's going, you know, the sun isn't going to last forever. It's in decline. It's in decay because it's a closed system. Whereas human life and all life, living systems, are expanding. And they are, they're developing. Their evolution has, continues to happen, and they expand and get larger. So species-wise, and so his conclusion is that there's a order comes from disorder, since in these ecosystems, you're moving into this entropic environment in order to gather things back, and then you also, so and you bring them home, so to speak, and you deck your home out with them, and they produce a kind of order, the order is extracted from that disorder. And life depends on order. So this is this question of order now sneaks back in to the second law of thermodynamics in order to talk, basically introduce what happened in the late 20th century, which was complexity theory, which had to do with irreversible systems like thunderstorms and dissipative practices that were, you know, had to do with heat. So it was basically a turn away from Newtonian physics. But not to go into that, because it's a, that, I mean, that's an, I'm going to be saying this very often, like there's so much in there that is relevant to this, but it's, it at the moment I'm just trying to lay the ground. However, the issues of biomodernity, if we can just adjust, you know, accept that term into architecture for a moment, would seem to be quite different for architecture as such. I want to give you another one of these things to look at. I'm going backwards again. This is the U House by Toyo Ito for his daughter, I believe, who lost her mother. And it, so it's closed in a grieving space. Some claim, at least because architecture's relationship to life, culture, and politics is always regarded rather obliquely, and at worst, it's really opaque. Like, we know it happens. We know that architecture is, like, deeply impacting on culture, but we can't track it, you know, exactly. We say, oh, this building, yes, of course, it has to be doing that because it's, you know, it's huge, and it's a huge object, and because it, you know, you're going in and out, and you're living there, and all sorts of relationships, so you know it's doing something, but how to track it is very difficult. Some claim enormous powers of radicalization for architectural work, and others ridicule and revile the field as utterly complicitous with centralized power structures. It is often the case that architects must thread a complex path through public and private authorities from whom architecture's realization must be won. But just as often, architects lay claim to a separation from the external authorities that free architectures to pursue in their own way symbolic and material references to both public and private life. It is clear, however, that as we, people, you know, I'm not going to say animals, but not just as humans, but as living beings, that there are more biologically managed by technopolitics. What is this? That as we people are more biologically managed by technopolitics of architecture's symbolic work, i.e., design. Sorry for a second here. I'm sorry, this got mixed up here, I think, which is fascinating, that biotechnical apparatuses attempt to reform life in both banal ways like air conditioning and less banal ways like smart houses that now are going to tell you when to turn on your light and when to turn it off or to turn on your heat. The way in which robotics will come into this picture. So, moving to the next question with a short introduction to that, is why do we need the provocation I'm proposing by bringing you, you know, Agamben's sort of concern about our relationship to technology, apparatuses, institutions, governments, and so forth. Why do we need to throw architecture into some hyperbolic circuitry of life, bare life, nervous systems, global data projects that are meant to corral and potentially harm people and so forth if they exist, as well as the good systems? Why is it biological life rather than people that has become what is at stake? We design for people, for a public, a genetic, generic conception of social life, a typology of subjects such as business people or school teachers or affordably housed people. The biological, architects might say, properly belongs to genetic science and medicine. or to psychoanalysis and cognitive research. The biological is an aspect of personhood that is necessary but not sufficient to form what we see as our whole identity. It is perilously close to an essentialist subjectivity. A provisional answer to these objections is that architectural work itself, through its history, frequently has invoked the biological. Architects routinely refer to the experience of space and fields of perception and cognitive sensoriums. We believe that we can access our own experience, which is an enormous assumption about our cognitive abilities. Architectures embrace research in neuroscience and anthropology and sociology and psychology and fashion notions of the organic, the natural, the earth-like and green. So we're in that narrative. And now, as I've been very interested in seeing in Singapore in the most extraordinary way, we are beginning to sort of bring nature into this technological world that we've built because we feel the loss, certain sense of the immediacy of the nature with the big N, in other words, the nature that we think we know about. And so we are exploring possibility that the architecture can wear a cloak of greenery to acknowledge a larger environment on which we depend. Biomodern relations between life, apparatuses, milieu, and environments are at work in that process in a subtle way that we have yet to see what happens. So the second part, and I think I'm sort of, the second part. Second part is about technology. And it will double back on the first part, but in a peculiar way. And it has to do with Heidegger, who, there's a controversial figure for his politics, and also huge influence on the theory that I was studying at a certain point at Johns Hopkins University, and then came to be entering theoretical work that I was doing after that through the post-structural deconstructive period with Jacques Derrida and so forth. And Heidegger was very influential on a lot of those philosophies that were trying to begin to open up architectural discourse and critique it in various ways. But I want to spend a few minutes on Heidegger, or a little bit of time on Heidegger, his famous essay, The Question of Technology. And because we think we know what nature is, we think we know what technology is. And we could say, well, if I asked you what technology was, you would point to something and say, that's technology, or this is technology, here, this is technology. And so we see it, and we know something about using it. Some know more than others about that. But Heidegger argues that that's not enough. That's true. We point to it, and you're right, this is technology. But it doesn't explain how something pursues its course, the way it remains through time as what it is. And so there's a temporal element to it, and he goes on to sort of then build his case for like what that means. It pursues its course. Technology pursues its course. This object pursues its way, through the world, through different hands, through who knows what, being stored away for a while to becoming obsolete. So there's a kind of path for technology. He gets to the point where he goes on, he says it is very much a means to an end. Like this would be good for nothing but what it's good for. And so it's definitely a means for an end, and Heidegger agrees with that. But he says there's also this question of instrumentality. And the question of instrumentality, the way it works, and again, the way it pursues its course, he wants to go into more deeply. And he says that instrumentality is something that causes something else. And it's true, it's hard to follow him sometimes because he invents various sort of ways of labeling things. But in this case, it makes pretty much sense because the instrumentality of a technical device, and technology applies to so many things other than just technical devices, but let's just stick with that for a minute, that for example, the material that you would use or need to build this device, that's one thing. You have to have the instrument, that's an instrumentality, that instrumentalizes this to have material. Two, you need a form, and the form needs to be designed. And so that too causes something. The instrumentality needs to be responsible for the form and for the material. And three, it has a destination. It's going to do something, and you start out with its destination to a certain degree. You have to know where you're going to a certain degree. So once again, their instrumentality is related to the destination of the object. And then the fourth is, and he uses an interesting example of building, making a silver chalice or a silver cup. But he says then you have to complete it, and the completion of it is as much a instrumental act as, the beginning of it. Instrumentality is responsible, and this isn't moral responsibility, but indebted to the material, the form, the destination, and the completion of this object. And in that manner, you're not manipulating materials or making something, in some vague way. What you're doing is you're actually bringing this thing forth and giving it a kind of presence. And it's not only a thing or an object, but it immediately becomes the conceptual thing, the idea of the object. And this is actually from Plato, that Plato explains objects in terms of not just some empirical thing that's detached from the idea, but both the eidos is the word, the idea and the object belong to each other. You wouldn't go through the material, the form. How could you possibly do a device without an idea? You wouldn't know what material. You wouldn't choose. You don't randomly choose the material. You go and find out which material was strongest or what's popular or whatever is working well and so forth. And in doing that, you bring this forth and you give it a presence and a physical presence, but also an ideational or conceptual presence. And that bringing forth is what he suggests is what objects were for a very long time in history. And then he says, we made a move, we made a shift. We shifted to modern technology, and he brings science into that, scientific technology. And, science starts with the beginning of being human, so science in some form has been around for all time. But it's really the codification or the institutionalization of science that now begins to change that relationship to the object and the technical device or the technicity of things. And it goes beyond this bringing forth thing. It goes on, part of this modern technology, but the technology he ends up referring to is the technology, say, of the dam, or other technologies, and I've robot is a peculiar example of this, much more obviously intended to, its intentions are very complex. I think the grid and the powers of what develops in mathematics and geometry from Renaissance forward is about the calculability of space and the homogeneity of space. And what he says about this modern shift is that it's now technology goes beyond the bringing forth and it begins to set nature up. It unlocks energy. It stores energy. It distributes energy. It regulates energy. And it goes beyond presencing. It makes objects into what he ultimately calls a standing reserve. It is something that is going to be specifically there for us to use in a particular way. And its influence, obvious, is, of course, we are going to use it. Why would we make it otherwise? But that it makes now, through this sort of more scientific understanding of these things we can do with it, particularly in the realm of energy, is that we begin to make unreasonable demands on nature, is how he puts it, and we exhaust it. And we know that's been the case, you know, that's been the case, that we came to a point, and this is all connected, you know, with many other forces. It's not just a simple line of development of this sort of relationship, but it changes things from being merely objects to things that will now have kind of an explosive aspect to them, like an airplane or something. He says an airplane is not an object, it's a standing reserve. It's a reserve of energy. It's a reserve of, the distribution of energy all over the world. It's related to fuel. It's related to storage of fuel. It's related to all these things where you're taking things away from the nature with a small n, in a sense, in order to claim it for the production of technology. And the final kind of description of that, he says, is it enframes later, meaning that it captures it. And there's a danger to this, and we already know the danger of that. And Agamben also talks about this with the cell phone. The danger is that we will be ending up making human beings standing reserve through cloning, biopolitics, bioscience, and so forth. So he ends on a kind of bad note that it's that this shift, this modern shift, is threatening in that way and dangerous for us. So it's, you know, again, I'm not trying to talk about the negative side of technology. We know that technology is, like, you know, incredibly powerful. And what it's done so far is unbelievable. And our ability to keep producing technologies that we have is unbelievable. It's unbelievable. It's just little us, you know, with our little, you know, tools and our heads thinking of ways in which this or that happens, and our inquiry into nature through, what was it in the news today about this incredible new telescope that's in space that now is opening up the whole brand new galaxy system that is happened some billions of years ago. So it's incredible what we've done. And yet we've also it's a slippery relationship now. It's not so clear that what it's for, or who's it for. And we know that it contributes to a disordering of many aspects of culture at the same time that it reorders, you know, our relationship to ourselves, our buildings, our thinking, everything else. So I put that there to, in a way, sort of inflect the Agamben biomodernity and the sort of forces of the apparatus and how the apparatus then enters into a sort of technological mode and where that, what that sort of theorization of that might be a sort of beginning of ways of thinking that take us to a different conclusion than just go forward and, you know, let's have the next Apple purchase. tomorrow because there's a new computer, you know, that we want to have because everybody else has it. So that's part two. And I think I'm also did the Apple campus for its peculiar sort of satellite look, and you know, as if it's going to take off. And the shed in New York belongs to a slightly different category. But so the third part is this part where I just wanted to play around, or just to sort of try to list to some degree, or let us remember something. So it has a couple of things that are related to the first two, but are a little different. And I start with Timothy Morton, who you may or may not know, who's written a book called Ecology Without Nature, with a capital N, Rethinking Environmental Aesthetics is what he's doing. He's coming from a kind of literary background. There's something in the question of nature that is like relentlessly crazy. Timothy Morton, in this book, Ecology Without Nature, wishes to throw nature out of the picture, yet it abides in his very word. You know, eco in bed with logos, language in bed with nature. He means ecology without nature, capital N, which is technologized, romanticized, and reified nature, not necessarily Kant's nature, which affords nature its distance, but idealizes the over there. He means nature such as that which put in place by 19th century romantics and 20th century modernists. This is the nature he wants to throw out. 20th century modernists and ourselves, every minute of every day, through representational systems, we're talking about nature, what a beautiful moon it is, and how we idealize it. You know, it's beautiful, and its beauty is important to us. These are definitions of nature that are capable of a kind of gratification, apparent accessibility, and accordingly, it belong to our interest in appropriating it. And again, the technology is a kind of appropriation of nature in its more active way. Morton doesn't mean the small n nature, which cannot gratify, because it's irreducible. It's unable to be simplified or transformed into a form or a singular condition. That nature can be approached, as Morton suggests, only in this ambient modality. And I don't know what he's talking about exactly. Ambient modality, meaning a suspension in a certain sense of the sort of logic of nature that we like to apply, and to move into some more atmospheric, like Bruno Latour talks about, a more atmospheric, or Peter Sloterdijk's spheres, where he's going to change our occupation on Earth, and we're going to live in bubbles, you know, is what he's thinking. And bubble architecture is quite popular, actually, right now. It's a huge epistemological, knowledge-based discursive ungainliness to keep calling out nature in nature, nature in not nature, and so forth. The problem is that nothing is not nature. It is therefore difficult to throw nature out, even in its simplified and false manifestations. This is not meant to be a kumbaya conclusion. It's not about Lovelock's Gaia principle of universal interconnectivity, which might give us some delusional hope, so much as it is working through different ways of seeing and accounting for living systems and objects that inevitably refer to how living systems use, curate, perceive, reflect, grasp, turn into knowledge, objects for various purposes. Morton and Graham Harman, who, you know, the object-oriented ontology, this is a philosophical concept now, have pursued a philosophical path that follows in many respects Heidegger's ontological relations between human beings and things. In Heidegger's ontology, we as beings hang out in the open of nothingness while our minds translate and do this unconcealing of objects and things, naming them, describing them, qualifying them, representing them, in order to store them for use, and as mentioned before, for use, you know, use, our use, even if it's just visual entertainment. Objects in Morton's book include not only technological productions, but also rocks and trees and landscapes and climates, some of which he calls hyper-objects. In Morton's ontology, objects have visible and tangible aspects, but invisible, unknowable being. What is present at hand, lying before us, as Heidegger argued, is the visible surface of objects. And Harman's work points to a qualification of objects as a failure to understand that we don't know anything about objects, we don't relate to them. They withdraw from us. We see their surface, but they withdraw from us ontologically. One common characteristic of all living systems, and I'm making a little shift here out of the Morton and Graham Harman 000 stuff because it goes on in another direction. And because I want to go back to the question of ecosystems and just again understand certain kind of ways in which they've been discussed, ecosystems. I think it's still true that the definition of living systems as autopoietic systems by the Chilean biologists Humberto Maturana and Francisco Varela, who proposed this definition of life in 1972 in order to directly describe what takes place in the dynamics of the autonomy proper to living systems. In other words, we are autonomous. Can you believe this? We walk around just all by ourselves. We have to drink and eat in order to keep going. But we're just, you know, we're here. We're not plugged in. We're just autonomous entities. They identified the autopoietic system as autonomous. And then this is crucial, organizationally closed systems that are also necessarily energetically open systems. And I mentioned that a few minutes ago about we're closed in the sense that we're species. We have a special kind of cognitive apparatus, and we have a very specific kind of autonomy that belongs to us, you know, as a species, and that's closed. We're not, you know, and except for under very exceptional circumstances, we just stay within our tribe, so to speak. But what? We can't live without getting fuel and oxygen and all sorts of things from the environment. So we have to have energetically open systems so that we can be energized as this autonomous entity. So that's what an autopoietic system is, and autopoietic system is also self-production. We keep reproducing ourselves to maintain our species. These systems are very artful, creatively resourceful, you could say. We're very resourceful. The reason we have technology is because we're so resourceful that we can use the environment in ways that are, and every organism does this in its way. It operates according to its cognitive makeup. It's specific and unique to each organism. So it's not just us that has technology. There are observable technologies in almost every species. Maturana's later work, in particular, was influenced by Jacob van Uschkull, who was also influenced by Agamben and who also influenced Heidegger and Agamben and intersected with second-order cybernetic theory. His investigation into the animal environment, Agamben writes, are contemporary with both quantum physics and the artistic avant-garde period. Like them, they express the unreserved abandonment of every anthropocentric perspective in the life sciences and the radical dehumanization of the image of nature. Too often, he affirms, we imagine that the relations a certain animal subject has to things in its environment take place in the same space and in the same time as those which bind us to the objects of our human world. Uchkul shows that such a unitary world does not exist, just as a space and time that are equal for all living things do not exist. And we've been speaking, you know, lately about multiple species, thinking of other species coming into our rights system, our legal rights system, our human rights systems, giving rights to other species. And it's partly the problem that you would say the law for the species is very, another species is very different than the law for us. It would be very hard to ascribe human laws to, you know, to cow laws or to other. We want this transspeciation in order to somehow learn more about how nature works, and we want to be protective of it the way we're protected by human laws, humanist laws. And yet it would imply that we were now almost colonizing those species to do that. In Maturana's words, living systems are cognitive systems, and living is a process of cognition. In other words, a process of how you know what you know, how what you use what you know. And this statement is valid for all organisms with or without nervous systems. The conceptual framing of the autopoietic system is extraordinary, actually, for its systemic application to all living systems. And I apologize for not actually giving you the lowdown on what's happening at this moment in time around the autopoietic system. I have done some research on that, and it's pretty fuzzy. A lot of what happened after the autopoietic system is still, I think, understood scientifically to be correct. But the biologists who, you know, originally proposed that also went on to make other sorts of assumptions about how we experience things. Therefore, if cognition is what creates us as a species, and some of that I agree with, and others I just don't understand exactly what they're doing. And I think that there are other aspects of this that are also have developed. But just taking this one thing, this autopoietic system, I think is really interesting to think about. Helps us, in a way, begin to understand also our relationship to this peculiar housing that we design for ourselves and what we think about the ordering of our lives in relationship to. That we are what, where the energy and the extraction of order and the exchanges of order and disorder is working through this, both a closed and an openness, an energetic openness and an organizational closure. And I think that pertains at a number of different scales. Both the internal closure of the autopoietic system and its openness to the environment point to the infinitely complex ways, visible and invisible, innate and epigenetic, in which individuals and societies are cohered and technologies formed. Antiquity to present-day philosophers, and not just in the Western world, architects, economists, politicians, cyberneticists, developmental biologists, and so forth, have grappled with this relationship. The imputed conception of nature that emerges from the autopoietic system is not one thing, organic or inorganic, but a recombinant snapshot, in a way, at any given moment of a play of relations between living and non-living systems and environments over long periods of time. In all of these discussions, from metaphysics to physics to biotechnic and autopoietic systems, the question of nature still remains slippery. Zizek, I don't know if you're familiar with Zizek, but he's great to listen to on YouTube. He's a philosopher, is remarking on everything in the world at all times, and is quite persuasive and smart. He says the problem for humans is not nature, but our omnipotence over nature. If we examine the scope and meaning of such omnipotence, Zizek continues, it becomes clear there's no nature for humans that is separate from our need and desire for omnipotence or control over it. And this is a little bit behind what Heidegger says about omnipotence is true, but then there's this other thing that it's more, it's not just control, but it's instrumentality, so that he, I mean, that, that move forward beyond omnipotence. But here, Zizek continues that it becomes, that our desire for omnipotence is essentially a constitutive feature of the nature we posit as that which lies outside of us. The problem of the outside of us, nature being outside of us, is now on everybody's mind. The out there, you know, it's out there, and it's not right, you know, right here, is on everybody's mind now, this sort of remote relationship that allows us to feel this sense of, or to develop this omnipotent relationship. I think in, to some degree, every species engages in a certain amount of omnipotence. This part is, again, just sort of the ordering part of buildings that take on the problems of architectural ecosystems to a certain degree that require this programmatic sort of continuity and sort of conventionality. Peter Eisman, for example, in House 6 does this bedroom with a split through the bed where, in a sense, he's sort of arguing with the master bedroom concept. Examples of technology that where, you know, where we're trying, this is about the, you know, sort of the gradual way in which all our archival material, all of our history is now being sort of archivally, digitally archived and by the, you know, technology. This is Nouvelle's on Branly in Paris, where he did this for one of the first walls where it covered with the plants. And I put this here because of this, we're back again in a little bit at the moment where we're trying to think of our relationship to nature and architecture. Bringing plants and putting them up on the walls is such an interesting an odd development. I don't know why Nouvelle was doing that at the African American project he was doing for the Cape Branly, but it was remarkable to see at that time, and it's now it's coming to the fore in other ways as well. I'm almost done with this particular list and this problem of I want to know if I want to go on with omnipotence to the next level, but I think I want to spend the last few minutes, or the last, what time is it? The last 10 minutes maybe, on Kant's theory of the sublime, just to bring him into play. And because we still believe in the sublime, and the sublime is a definite theory of nature, and for Kant, in a way, nature was at a distance. He said we didn't understand anything about it, but we encounter its immensity as a sensory and aesthetic experience that threatens to destabilize our existence. When we go and see Niagara Falls or something, when we see mountains, you know, or when we see giant rivers like the Congo River or something, that we on the one hand we say, oh, it's very beautiful, how magnificent, but Kant remarks that this moment is potentially becomes so subjective and is so overpowering that we are in danger of losing our reasoning powers, and reason is everything for Kant. The faculty of reason is a given for Kant. It's a priori structuring of cognitive faculties. And Kantian, this was in the 18th century, and so that Kant was most influential, but he is still deeply influential on theories of nature. Because you can find him popping up in Deleuze's work and in a lot of other people's work as well. then this a priori structuring of the cognitive faculties, which was true. I mean, even in the 18th century, he was noticing that there was this, you know, power of the cognitive faculty. And Kant's theory of aesthetic perception attempts a unification of experience with this faculty of reason. His assumption is that experience is subjective, therefore it must be processed, universalized by reason, because the subjective is just one opinion, you know, it's our opinion, it's what we see, which isn't what everybody else sees necessarily. So that perception for Kant is one means by which reason processes experience. In the case of the sublime, nature overwhelms our senses, but reason helps us gain our sense of superiority over it again. And this, I always think of Mount Everest when I read Kant, because Mount Everest is this incredibly difficult mountain to climb that hundreds of people try to climb every year. And nature, and no matter how many times you know, you're walking, you're trying to climb Mount Everest, and people's bodies are lying along the path, you're going frozen from day before because of some terrible storm. No matter what, there's always this entry into Mount Everest as if it were like, you know, a required sort of natural experience. And it's and so it puts the whole realm of the sublime into the realm of the, you know, the gas mask or lack of oxygen, where you're beginning to get dizzy, and you know many people have died on this climb. And so it's the perception of this begins to blur with the altitude. In the case of the sublime, therefore the nature overwhelms our senses, and regaining superiority of that is the battle that people are fighting on Mount Everest. A necessary distance is reestablished that requires us to push nature back into a calculable scale in relation to ourselves, and that's literally the scale of our bodies. Our aptitude for omnipotence, in Kant's terms, depend on the varied meanings of this distance and its periodic collapse and recovery. This faculty of overcoming, echoed in Zizek's concept of omnipotence, arises more purposefully as an aesthetic experiential theory in Kant's age, the Enlightenment, when science threatened to undermine moral and religious beliefs, and the world of human beings began to be populated by us, human Homo sapiens, a name given by Carl Linnaeus in 1758. A species that was understood to be on its own at the top of the evolutionary tree. The modern concept of omnipotence over nature that arose in the 18th century transformed earlier beliefs that nature was given to humans by divine authority to use as needed into an a priori right that humans grant to themselves. We've subsequently naturalized this right and rendered it irrefutable, not open to question. Once we identify ourselves as Homo sapiens, we lose most of the ground of sympathy or contentious identifications with non-humans. Even our supposed sadness about nature is utilitarian. We lament the loss of our personal delight and pleasure in nature. The poet, scientist, father of taxonomy, Linnaeus, never actually defines the characteristics of the species Homo sapiens. Every other animal and plant is known by descriptions of physical structure and behavior. We know ourselves as a species and as individuals through self-reflection. What Linnaeus said to people who said, you know, well, what are our characteristics? He said, look in the mirror. And the mirror plays this symbolic aspect to which we are still looking at ourselves through our selfie. And because it forms us. So the interest of bringing up Kant here has something to do with this relationship of the body to nature, the size of the scale of the body. And I was thinking of this in regard to the scale of the, say, the buildings in Singapore and the skyscrapers in New York and so forth. And I'm interested in how those scalar relationships have developed over time. You know, Mies van der Rohe in the Seagram building has a datum, and we used to use a datum for, you know, showing where the human body, average human body would, you know, be, where your eyes would be. And now we don't use those because we no longer are worried or care that much about it. I'm not even sure. I haven't read anything specifically that suggests why we stopped doing the datum per se, except that now it's better to, now you could say the idea is to overwhelm you as a sub, and to try to acquire the sublime. I want to conclude kind of on that note because Kant talks a lot about the unit of measure and how measure is the human body in relation to nature, and that connects in a certain sense with the omnipotence and the self-reflection and the way in which we use technology and so forth. Yeah, I don't want to finish too abruptly, but I think that's all I want to say for today, if that's okay.